Macmillan Audio presents Curdle Creek by Yvonne Battle-Felton. Read for you by Joniece, Abbott-Pratt. Welcome to Curdle Creek. Population, 201. One in, one out. Home. It's 3 days before the moving on, and just like the sun rises and sets whether you see it or not, the moving on comes around year after year, same as the warding off, whether or not you believe in it. Traditions are like that, sure as a bronze church bell. We're all preparing for it in one way or the other. Even the ones who say there's no call for it, it's old-fashioned, we'll be damned. What does the moving on care about their reservations now, umpteen years in? Shadows flicker and dance along the walls like twin pallbearers. Every so often my stomach drops. Must be all the excitement. Running up the widows, the calling, the moving on, the warding off. All that coming and going, all that running. It'll be the busiest week in all Curdle Creek. I could die just thinking about it. The living room is hot, a little too hot if you ask me, but I'm not one to complain. May likes it that way, and May's company. Besides, an unwelcoming host is maybe not the worst thing you could be here, but there's no sense in getting on May's bad side. Not on the night before the names are called. Folks say the calling is down to luck. Folks whose names get called don't have much of it. If you believe that, you'll believe just about anything. Not that I think May would have anything to do with my name being called this year. She would do it if she had to. We'd all do it. But who would listen to her? A widow with a chorus of dead husbands as wide as the creek is long? May's name don't have any more luck to it than mine does. At least not until the running of the widows. A good run could change everything. Do you have your eye on anyone special this year? May asks. She's standing in front of the mirror, staring at me over her shoulder, while her slender fingers lace up her girdle, pushing parts into places I'm not sure they're meant to be. I lean back into my soft leather chair, tilt my head to the side, lick my lips, and roll my eyes slightly. Having my eye on somebody's got nothing to do with marriage. The first time's for love. The second's for luck. The third one, well, if you live long enough to have a third one, the third one's for life, so they say. Everybody knows that. I say. Try again, she says. You look like you're drooling. No one likes a desperate widow. You'll scare off all the good ones before it's even time, and you'll be single for another year. It's just like May to blame me for my predicament. Sooner or later, we all run out of luck. The running of the widows is like a second chance at it. Says so in the book. How is it seductive when you do it, and not becoming when it's me? Practice, dear, she says, sounding just like Mother Opal. An unpeeled fruit is sure to waste. I roll my eyes for real this time. Book one. The law of attraction, we say together. We laugh, and since we're alone, we do it out loud. It feels good, too. I haven't had much reason for laughter since the children left, and then my Moses. First, the calling, then the moving on, not 12 months after. May's bent over holding her sighs, and even from here I hear the pop followed by what sounds like a hot pan full of popcorn kernels. But isn't. Mounds of stretched brown flesh burst through the polyester girdle, leaving it pockmarked and wide open. She doesn't have to ask. I slide my tray of varnish, nail files, and ice to the side, slip my feet into my slippers, careful not to mess the polish, and start the operation of pulling and prodding things back into place. You sure you don't want to try a bigger one? I ask. I don't mean it to sound mean, but May flinches anyway. Everyone loves a supple bride, but loathes a supple widow. We can't all afford to pray to the gravity gods and hope for the best. I nod. I'm wearing two corsets, one for luck and another because I don't believe I have any. But if this body looks natural to her, who am I to say otherwise? Please don't quote my mother, I say. I touch my hand to her shoulder. May flinches once more. Your hands are freezing. Have you been playing in the cemetery again? Are they cold enough? I've been dipping my hands in and out of ice all evening. Cold hands yield good luck. It's an old widow's tale, but if nothing else, anyone who lives long enough to be an old widow knows a thing or two about luck. If they were any colder, you'd be lying up next to Moses. Down. I'd be lying down next to Moses. May the ancestors watch over his soul. If there is one, there ain't no way my Moses made it all the way to heaven. Not with all his carrying on in life. All that begging. Spare me, take her instead. Shameful. We make the sign of the cross to ward off my dead husband. I'd light another candle, but with the sitting room full of them, one more might cause a fire. We're meant to be praying to the mother fertility, like every other single sister, but instead, we're getting ready for the running of the widows, like any widow with good sense would be. Better than throwing salt over your shoulder, jumping six times before crossing a bridge, or spitting in the well. Latching on to another family is an almost foolproof way to not exactly beat the system, but the bigger the family, the better the luck. Or the better the chances your name won't be called in the morning. Not that moving on's not a privilege and all. You know, cold hands mean a cold heart, May says. She's always quoting one book or the other, trying to out-holy me. It's not a competition, but I throw in book four to shake her up. Desire is for the young, matrimony for the ready, I say. She giggles. Once we're dressed, I take the rollers out of my hair. It's twisty, just as I like it, with coils of gray blended with dark brown. Age looks good on me. I pucker up, slide on dark red lipstick. May's dark plum looks good against her skin. I tell her, and she blows me a kiss across the room. We set the table for four. One place for each of our dead husbands. I fix them both generous portions, plates piled high with macaroni and cheese, juicy slices of beef, plump shrimp, fat potatoes dripping with soured cream and fresh churned butter. Isn't that too much starch? May asks, as if dead people count calories. I think it'd be just fine, I say. I'd imagine they burned off a lot when they passed. From the running. I might have been a bit overzealous when it was time to ward off my Moses, but it was nothing as undignified as May's whooping and hollering, chasing poor Clifton's soul away. I could barely bear to watch, although of course I had to. Nobody in Curdle Creek misses the warden off, and what sort of best friend isn't at her friend's ceremony? One that's courting trouble, I can tell you that. Missing a ceremony as important as the warden off is just plain unneighborly. It's a good way to get yourself shunned. Being shunned is one step from being nominated, and being nominated is just as good as one foot hovering over the grave. Well, as being moved on. It's been 3 years since Moses departed. Wasn't May right there by my side, helping his spirit to move on? Then, year after year, right there performing the ceremony to keep him from coming back? So, of course, when May asked to join me tonight, since there was something unnatural about waiting for a dead husband you hoped wouldn't come to come, I said yes. Truth be told, once the council stopped checking that Moses wasn't hanging around haunting my bed at night, I stopped worrying about him coming back. I didn't tell anybody, though. There's nothing worse than an ungrateful widow. We mostly eat in silence, listening out for the oohs and moans. May jumps when the bell tolls six. That's not even the time when Clifton moved on. But we all have something that reminds us. Mine's the barn owl's eyes bright and wide like Moses's. Deep voices singing, I love you, you. The way he would have done if he'd ever said such a thing. The beef is too bloody. Pink slides around the plate. And I can't help but think the fork looks like a tiny pitchfork hunting it down. Still, it's tasty. And I pop it in my mouth as if it's my last meal. In a way it is. In 2 days' time, I'll be a new woman. Or at least a new bride again. I hope this next one has better luck than Moses's, though. Imagine your name being called on your wedding anniversary. As if bad luck runs in the family, I haven't been invited to a wedding since. If May and I hadn't married the same year, she might not have invited me to hers either. A toast, I say. I raise the jam jar full of mint julep and pretend to clink it against May's raised glass. May the dead find comfort in their graves. Book 13. To the moved on. We leave the plates around the table and settle down in the sitting room to gossip about wedding nights and first and last times. At 45, we're lucky to have second chances. We have the moving on to thank. A good moving on yields a robust harvest. 20 years of plenty means there have been more births than usual. The running of the widows, the calling, the moving on, the warding off, it's all a small price to pay for the safety of the town. It could be worse. Imagine being alone forever, May says. She settled into Moses's chair. Feet up on the coffee table like he used to do. The chair creaks and stops, creaks and stops, the same way it did when Moses was sitting there. Only he'd stop to listen for footsteps, as if one of the children would be fool enough to sneak back here after so long. May's still talking about the departed, like they're still here. Reminiscing about the time Moses fell off the ladder trying to fix the roof. You should be grateful the old fool didn't die that very day. Mysterious ways, I say. Thankfully, it was the moving on that took him. With one leg tucked under the other, her toes peeking out to wiggle when she rocks back, May looks like the chair was made just for her. We could grow old together. Best friends rocking back and forth, sharing secrets like we did when we didn't know any better. My mouth is suddenly dry. My hands are shaking. What if the old folks are wrong and the moved on can't come back? It wouldn't take long before the whole town was overflowing with moved on husbands, wives, sisters, and brothers. Come back, school marms, pastors, and neighbors. Popping up in the middle of services, living rooms, gatherings. It'd be enough to drive us all to the creek. I'd like to think they'd come back thankful. Once they'd seen the memorials, their names etched in the town stone, their leather-bound life book shelved in the library, the bustling town with its new stop sign and paved road, they'd be grateful to have played their part in Curdle Creek history. Not one soul left behind, we like to say. They'd be forgiven their ungraceful departing, the howling, name-calling, second-guessing and all, until their names were called again. According to Book 26, the warden off keeps souls from returning to Curdle Creek. As if anyone with good sense would come back here. Of course, there's worse places to end up than here. But if the dead suddenly do come back, it means the warden off don't work. Ain't nothing worse than warding off someone you loved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.